Hi everybody, let's start with our session. I'm Dimitris Pachos. I'm a researcher on Lab of Medical Physics on Medical School. I'm going to present you a lecture and hands-on. Do you all have laptops? Most of you. Okay. The lecture will be 5-10 minutes. The rest of the session will be a hands-on session. So it's better to have a laptop to work with the material. Now, for start, you can navigate to just a moment. You can navigate to the Kamei Summer School Program on the May website. If you haven't received an email with a login URL, you can create a new account. Because there are some voting, some evaluation at the end of the day, the procedure is automatically. After you navigate to the program, to the day program, you can click on the Open Educational Repositories session, and just to have the you have to log in to have access to the material. Sorry. So it's necessary to create an account if you don't have one to access the material here. So let's start from this. EDROAM. Αν δεν έχεις κωδικό EDROAM, θα πρέπει να πας στη γραμματεία να πάρεις ένα. So, for those of you for the next 2 minutes, let's do this. Now, after you log in the meanwhile, So you can navigate to the session page and access the material.
These are three attachments: the scenario, the manual for the software, and the presentation.
It's not necessary to open the presentation right now, just the scenario to help you with the steps. You can go to under Kamei to the main menu under Kamei Summer School Program and then click on Open Educational Repositories title. No. Just this. I'll guide you through the scenario. Everybody has access to the material? Okay, let's wait. In the meanwhile, I'll start with the presentation. Open Educational Repositories. How many of you heard of Open Educational Repositories? The rest? No? What are Open Educational Repositories? We're initiated with reference to three freedoms: the freedom to study a work and apply knowledge offered from this work, the freedom to redistribute copies of this work, and to make improvements or repurposing this work. The whole point was to give authors control over the integrity on their work and the right to be properly acknowledged, because If you create, for example, a PowerPoint presentation for a lecture, and you put effort on this presentation, you want to, your effort to be recognized. So, in this specific session, we're going to use, I'm going to show you and use a specific software. It's called Melina Plus. It's a Melina Plus is a piece of software that developed for a European project. The project is called M-Educator. What is M-Educator? M-Educator is a project, is a best practice network. We compared in the project two different solutions to create open educational repositories using Web2 technologies and using Web3 technologies. The main idea of the M-Educator project is to provide tools and methods to discover, retrieve, use, rate, reuse, repurpose educational medical content. Okay, all these are details that we are going to see in the scenario. Have you ever, let's make a little bit interactive this session. Have you ever wondered, we're talking a lot about open data, but who creates open data? Sorry, a little bit louder. Okay, how? Can you give an example, for example? A little bit louder, sorry. Okay. You have, for example, for some assessment on the university, I'm sure that you all of you create a PowerPoint presentation, yes. At least one. So, where? Where, exactly, where? In SlideShare, for example? Yes. In SlideShare. Have you ever do this? Yes, okay. What about the rest? Have you ever wondered who creates open data? Anyone. Sorry?
Anyone.
But do you? Have you created open data? Accessible by other users? Easy to find? Or, for example, have you ever uploaded a presentation in the SlideShare? No, why not? It was difficult to use the system, the SlideShare. It was the initial idea that you didn't want to share your work or something else. So, okay, it was a little bit difficult, you mean, to familiarize with the platform and upload your material there?
I don't know the platform at all. I don't know what's platform.
You haven't had SlideShare, you mean? Okay. Okay. Right, yes, I think so. But the main problem here is how you don't have only to create the open data, you have to give tools or methods to make them searchable by others, to make them easy to find. For example, we are talking now, today, for medical education content. Where, how many of you are doctors? Are they any doctors? No? Okay. How, where, for example, let's say there is Google, okay, but let's leave it for now. It's a powerful search engine, okay, but if you want to search for a specific medical content, where do you search? Are there any other websites, for example, the PubMed? They are. Who creates the data on the PubMed? A little bit louder, sorry.
Yes, if we talk about content that is developed from PISA, for example, medical education, usually they are, let's say, they stay inside the context of this university or the school. It's that common idea that everyone shares everything.
Okay.
Somewhere. When we talk about content of education in a medical school,
Okay, the truth is that there are a lot of ways to create open data. There are a lot of platforms, there are a lot of web tools and technologies, there are a lot of places to search for medical content, let's say for example, but there is a problem here that there is no specific standard when you're uploading, for example, a presentation or something else, and this makes it difficult not only to describe your work, but to categorize your work and share it with others. It's not very discoverable, very easy discoverable for others. Yes.
And there's another thing. If you categorize everything, how do you know that another person can use this? They don't probably have the same.
How do you know? In the microphone. Yes. Thanks.
Yes, even if you create and you categorize learning content, how can you know that everybody can use the same content? How do you know they have the same tools, access to the same tools, the same knowledge to use the tools,
exactly,
or
yes,
or the same LMSs and platforms they use probably?
So?
So it's not that easy to share. You can maybe create it, but share it's not the same.
Can you name one?
Like RDF.
No, RDF is not a framework, it's a
resource description framework that merges.
Yes, but you cannot use RDF standalone. You have to put RDF capabilities in a platform, in a software. RDF is not a piece of software that stands alone.
But this is the framework that you can use it in order to merge information from.
Yes, but it's a way to describe data in a semantic way.
Yeah.
So, in the last years, we are trying to standardize all this procedure, to produce ontologies, semantic frameworks to describe all this and make all this accessible with an easy way, I mean, in the web. That's why you see RDF here and Sparkle. This is two ways to discover, to share, to expose the semantic data. The M-Educator project, the Melina Plus platform, is a part of the M-Educator project. It's a platform that does exactly these very specific things. It allows you to upload your resource, whatever it is, even if it's not in a digital format. For example, you can upload information about a book that is printed, not digital. And after you upload, you enter some metadata. Do you know all what is metadata? It's data that describes data. We're going to see in a while. It's difficult to analyze in one-hour session all the fields that you have to complete, so we're going to see the basic fields today. But you can try yourself after this session. Now, this is most... Okay, let's go to this specific platform. Do you all have access to the material, to the scenario here? If yes, I want you to click on the PDF and open it. So, this is Melina Plus. It's an open educational repository for medical education learning objects. We can see some medical objects that are already uploaded by students, generally by the users of the platform. Let's start. Let me open the scenario too. Just to not forget about our previous question, who creates open data? There are tools, software tools, that creates automatically some open data, a large part of these. And the other part, it's created by specific users, by all of users. Let's go back to the platform. Okay, this is M-Educator. The first step on the scenario, you have to create an account. In the left sidebar, there is a user login box. Just click on the create new account. Here, you have to give a username, an email address, and your real name. Your real name, I explain this. Why do we ask about the real name? Because the platform, the Melina Plus platform, supports relationships between the users. You can collaborate with other users of the platform to create, together an educational object. So, in order to let the other users find you, you have to use your, we ask to use your real name, because with nicknames it's difficult to find other users. Yes. Oh yes, sorry. I think it's on the scenario. On the, it's written on the scenario. It's meducator3.net/melina+. It's right here. The scenario, just a moment, is on the Kamei Summer School. On the click on the Kamei Summer School drop down, open program, open the specific session, open educational repositories, and navigate to the end. But you have to be logged in to access the material. For those of you who don't have an MA account, you can create right now one. After you log in, you'll have access to the material here. Click on the left sidebar here. You have to click on create new account and just fill up the fields. Our colleagues can help you. It's Dr. Stathis Konstantinidis, Dr. Eleni Dafli, and Dr. Evdokimos Konstantinidis, who can help you creating the account. Sorry? You have to, yes, okay. You have to have two accounts to access the May website and the Melina website. Okay, it's a problem. Please wait. Yes, you will receive an email from Melina Plus. Just a moment. Yes, I have a spam protection. What about others? Have you created an account on Melina Plus? Okay.
Thank you.
see. Okay, I disable the spam protection for now. So, παιδιά, λογικά τώρα δεν πρέπει να έχει πρόβλημα. Just a moment, people. I see you here. But you haven't received the email. Have you checked spam, the spam folder? Let me resend the email just for you. And let's check sending email. Okay. That was successful. Why?
It's slow.
Είχα έναν ενεργοποιημένο ένα spam control, το οποίο επειδή όλα αυτά μπαίνουν από ένα IP, ενεργοποιήθηκε και δεν τους άφηνε, έπρεπε να περιμένω λίγο χρόνο. Αλλά τώρα το απενεργοποίησα.
Ναι, αλλά τώρα το απενεργοποίησα, λογικά δεν πρέπει να έχει πρόβλημα. Okay. Ήρθε. I see that most of you already logged in. This is just an administrative view, just for me. Should we proceed? Now, let's go back to the scenario. The second task, let's make a search on the platform. There are two types of searches, a very simple search and an extended search. Let's go to use the extended search. Search, go to explore in the main menu and click on search this platform. Okay, I see the system a little bit slow. Is it for you too or just for me? Yeah, it's probably the server. Okay. This is a very, very detailed form and very complicated form. Now, let's perform a search according to the scenario. Okay. Explore. Let's type a keyword, cancer, in the title here. All these fields are the metadata I told you before. We will enter this metadata when creating a new educational object. Now, this is already created. The resources that are we going to search, it's already created, so we have to choose. There are many, many options. In my opinion, this is not a user-friendly form. We are trying to improve it in some way, but it's difficult because there are a lot of fields. Now, let's filter our results and let's search only for videos, for example. In this field, media type, you can start typing a keyword, for example, videos, and if the server was a little more quicker, it would be an autocomplete list to select from. But it's not responding, at least for me. Sorry? Yes, I can, but is this okay now? A little bit more. Yes, but I think that everybody must close their browsers. And I can guide you through, yes. So, let's try to search something. Okay, after you enter the keywords, after you filter the desired results, you press for search for educational objects, and let's wait for a minute. No, I don't want this. It's still loading, unfortunately. Yes. Yes, it's a little bit messy, this form. You can specify a lot of possible search filters. For example, in the title field, you can specify exactly that you want the title to contain this word, or not to, or start with, or end with, and many other. We have to explain. It's better to explain these fields in the creation form, because this is a little bit messy. In the creation form, it's in order. It's still loading for me, unfortunately. Okay, in order to proceed with the session, I'm going to kindly ask you to, some of you, not all of you, but the most of you to close the browsers, to the browser session, so we can see it right here in the screen. No, no, just the tab with the Melina Plus website. Yes, in the meanwhile, you can ask anything you want.
That's why I'm asking, actually. What I'm trying to ask is, you categorize the information, the open educational resources here, somehow.
Yes.
So you have developed vocabularies, or
yes. Yes, we have developed an ontology, the M Educator ontology. The M Educator ontology is based on many other existing vocabularies. For example, I think Stathis ICD-10 vocabulary.
SNOMED.
Great. The application is the Melina Plus, but the Melina Plus uses the M Educator schema.
Okay. This educator schema
yes.
Uses
vocabulary. Yes, exactly.
And element set, because Dublin calls an element set.
Exactly.
Vocabularies, I mean,
about control vocabularies that we use. Yes. We also developed our own controlled vocabularies. Exactly, yes, it's free, it's available. It's available to use, but in order to use it, you have to implement it some in some piece of software, for example. Okay. This is still loading, unfortunately.
I can say you with one question.
Yes.
You said not to care about Google, but have you looked at how Google indexes this kind of pages with an ad version to actually Google?
What do you mean, how?
If you look for those pages, I mean, resources to Google, have you seen a difference in the way that these pages are indexed as opposed to regular other platforms?
Sorry.
No.
If Google uses what M Educator schema?
Metadata,
yes, Google, but yes, but Google has its own algorithms
yes.
And its own metadata. It's in a big part unknown to the public. Nobody knows how exactly Google indexes its results, but it's definitely collects some metadata. We don't know what metadata. But I said before, let's leave Google apart, because when you search for something in Google, usually returns thousands of results. So what do? You're searching in the results, in the data set, in the returning data set. And if yes, how do you know that a returned result it's free, for example, to redistribute it? This is a matter of licensing. The M Educator platform tries to solve all these things, not just to return you the most relevant results, but also to return the information for permissioning, for licensing. For example, if you cannot use this return result for your for a presentation of yours, or there are other types of license that allows you to do this. In Google, many of us, even myself, let's say that we use the results without appropriate licensing. We take a picture, okay, put it in the presentation. But then what? If you want to open your, to share your educational object, all these things must be solved because you cannot redistribute a picture that you don't have the permission to do it. The M-Educator platform tries to solve all these things. Unfortunately, the main idea is that you can use the M-Educator schema in your learning management system. For example, many universities have Moodle. Other universities have Blackboard or another learning management system, another LMS. So if you power it with M-Educator schema, which is not very difficult. We already implemented solutions about for Drupal, for Moodle, for Open Labyrinth, for example. The main idea is that if you empower these platforms with M-Educator schema, they can talk to each other. You can search for a specific term, let's say for a cancer video from Mayo Clinic, not only in your LMS, but in all other connected LMS, because all these systems use the same schema. They know how to talk each other, to one to each other. So the return result will be, let's say, a graph from the instances that use an educator schema. At least this is the main idea. Yes? Okay, let's see the data from the manual, because unfortunately the server stopped responding. Okay. What is the question?
What kind of data can somebody upload?
Anything you want, even if it's not in a digital format. For example, if it is a book. A printed book. You can share it.
And the database runs in the cloud, and you only need the connection, for example, to your LMS, but this runs in the cloud?
Not in the cloud. What do you mean by run in the cloud? This is a standalone LMS systems. Let's say that you can upload your learning resource in this system, but in any other system that it's... In a server in our medical school, for example, this specific system. Yes. Yes. Okay. Let me explain. It's a little bit technical. Yes. This platform exposes a SparkQL endpoint and has a SparkQL registry. The SparkQL registry contains many SparkQL endpoints from other platforms that it's based on M-Educator schema. So if you can inform me that you have a platform, a Moodle, a Drupal, or something else, you just have to give me your SparkQL endpoint to put it in the registry. So once I put it on the registry, you can search in my system, you can search in your system, and get the same results. Because the query is not only to my database, but also in your database. Yes, okay, yes. In a general way, yes. But it's a decentralized solution. It's not a centralized solution. Let's put it all in a database. And M-Educator compared two solutions. The one solution was to centralize all this information in a database, in a big database. The second solution was this solution, to decentralize the information. Instead of having one big database, why not having many databases, many small databases that they can talk to each other. through SparkQL technology. We can take a look on the field when creating the another step of the scenario was to search for a YouTube video and then create it as an educational object in the platform. You can do this. Although you don't own the video, you can describe it. No, nobody restricts you to describe a video that's already in YouTube. With the description, by adding metadata, you allow other users to easily find this video because the metadata allows the platform to categorize this video. For example, to categorize it if it's free or not for use, for redistribution, I mean. So let's take a look on the fields. There are many fields. Okay. When creating a new educational object in the platform, of course, we have to give a title. Okay. Now, there are two possible situations. The one is to have as a file or as a zip file or something else to actually own this data. Yes. This. What do you mean?
When it comes to the content.
Yes, what do you mean?
If I write a title, is it the, do you call a guideline or a standard? How do you know what the title that I upload? Someone else will understand in the same way with me.
Okay. When you, let's say that you created your educational objects, uploaded, etc. Now, other users of the platform can see not only your object, but also the metadata, the description of your object, and they can rate it. So if you have a video for cancer and you said in the title that it is a video for dentist, for example, it's totally wrong. You will receive low rates from the users. We can control what, of course, what are you going to write in the title. It's up to you. This is a possible danger, let's say, but if many users rate your object in a low, give a low rate to your object. This is, for example, how can I say it? This is something that says to me that is a low quality object that has. Sorry, can you repeat the question? You upload an object?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
And then we try to make some learning objectives from my course.
Okay.
How do you make sure that it makes the learning
objectives
of your course?
Otherwise, how can you use it? Why should would you want to? Yeah, just a complete question. Why would you want to access this if it's not, if it's useless for you? Because it's.
I'm not sure I understand the question. Why? If it's useless for me, why?
Develop a content for one, let's say, one part of one of your course. You have one course and you have one three learning objectives and you have one learning activity, a video, let's say.
Yes.
To address this learning objective. And you upload this material to an educator. And I am from another country.
Okay.
And I'm also connected to an educator.
Okay.
And I want to access this, but it's not applicable to my country because we do this the same thing in a different way. So this.
Yes, but
that's.
You
can only describe this in some material. But how? If I don't understand it? I mean, if I don't understand it, the face of the content, how can you use it? What can you use? What kind of content is it?
When you
use,
for example, when you create a presentation, whether you try to find information you don't know the topic really well, or you find information and present it in the context that you want, if you find the presentation of the page, for example,
I'm not sure I understand the question. Let me decide if it's useless for me or not. Upload it, your object, describe it, and let me decide if it's worth getting into it. Then, okay, then, then before creating your educational objects, in your real life, I mean, then maybe you can perform a search here and see what other users created on this specific field you're referring to. What other users? If you find a video that it's useful for you and the permission of the video allows you to use it, then you can take it, use it. If you wanted to upload again the same video, it's a repurposing. This is called a repurposing. You upload again, but you have to change something. I mean, it's not why upload the same video again. If you change something, for example, the language, or if you add the description or something else, this is a repurposing of the same video. And these two objects, they are connected in the platform because other users will know that your video is connected to my initial video. It's a repurposed version of my. This can be seen as a, we have in papers, we have a citation index. If a paper is good, other users cite it. This way, if a learning object is good, then many users will use this specific object, maybe repurpose it, and this repurposing index, it's let's say a quality ranking of the object. If it's good, many users will use it. They will refer you. Does this answer your question? Yes. Yes.
Long, long time trying to guarantee that the case is perfect, and hours, hundreds of hours in committee getting agreement from all 17 medical schools the case is good enough. Even with that, nobody uses the case as is. They still take it and repurpose it. So all you need is the descriptor and permission. Does that help a bit?
Yes.
Yeah, because the guarantee system, I thought, is worth nothing. That was. But logically, that would make sense. But no teacher, no lecturer I've ever met says, here's a chapter from the book, go read that. That's good enough for my lecture. They never do that.
So at the very start, when you create a new object, another question, yes.
Is there any kind of version control or version history of the material?
What do you mean?
Someone makes a learning object,
okay,
and someone else repurposes it,
exactly,
or changes something.
Yes.
Is there a history of that so that someone, somebody can?
These two objects are connected. You can see the initial object, and you can see the repurposing version of the object. So it's not exactly a version control. I think you understand the difference,
okay.
But it's connected, the two objects. They are connected. So you can take a look from where the object began and where it goes.
Okay.
It's even, we even keep geo information. For example, let's say that we make a video that you can see in the platform if many users from US use it, you can see this, that there are 10 repurposing objects based on your video
and the 9 are from US, from United States. That is a piece of information, for example. Not only the connection, but another piece of information about the repurposing of the object. The server is completely stuck. I'm very sorry about this. When you create a new object, you have to give a main identifier. This main identifier can create it automatically by you. If you upload the object, it has a unique URI in the system. But in case your object already exists somewhere, for example, a YouTube video, you can provide the URL of the YouTube video. It must be one way or another, it must be a unique identifier, usually a URL. But also can be, for example, an ISBN, if we're talking for books. Then, another important thing that I want to explain is the licensing of the object. This is a very base thing. Yes?
We ran out of time.
Oh. Okay. Let me just say 30 seconds about licensing. You have to choose a license. This is a mandatory field. You have to choose a license. Otherwise, you cannot upload it. There are a lot of license and a lot of, let's say, types. These are the most common licenses. It's based on Creative Commons. There are different things among the license. For example, you can allow other users to use your material, but not for commercial purpose. If this license doesn't switch to your object, you can enter your own license. But one way or another, the end user must know if what license the object have and if it can use it. For example, you can you cannot allow other users to repurpose your object if you don't wish. There are many other fields. We are out of time, unfortunately. The quality, for example. The language is another mandatory field. Yes. 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 Yes.
Applied here through your repository.
The same license? I don't understand the question. Yes, YouTube videos have a license of its own.
Yes.
So first, you have to be sure that the creator of the YouTube video allows you to repurpose this video.
Yes. How is that regulated within your repository? How do you include or exclude videos? I mean, how is this managed? Because I can pick any video, it sounds like, from YouTube.
Sorry, you can pick any video to describe it, not to repurpose it.
Right, but I can bring it in here, in your
repository. No, you cannot bring it here.
Okay.
Here you can put only the URL of the YouTube video.
Yes, but then when it comes, I understand that, when it comes to licensing,
yes.
What do I do?
You enter the YouTube license.
How do you regulate that if that's done properly? How is this checked by somebody?
Yes. Yes.
But if there are discrepancies there?
Yes. And moreover, there is a procedure, let's say, we call it quality control procedure. In the system, there are specific users, experts, that they have a reviewer role. So, the reviewers, you create a new object. This must be reviewed from a reviewer, if the expert. If the reviewer has comments, enter into the system sends an email to you, you make some changes, and then again the object re-reviewed by the user, by the expert, and only if the reviewer accepts the object and the metadata, the object is published. So there is a quality control, let's say, if you enter a wrong license for the video, there will be a control, a quality control for this. And of course, as Stathis said, other users can report it, that this video, this object, it's not, it doesn't have this license, it's wrong. It's difficult to explain all this without seeing the system. Unfortunately, the server today, no, it's completely stuck, I'm sorry. I wanted to close the session. You can take a look on the Melina Plus manual. It's a very detailed manual and describes all these things, the fields, the what the meaning of the fields, how can you create a new object, how can you collaborate with other users on creation this object, how can you share this object, and many, many other things. So if anyone wants to dive more on this, he can read the manual. Yes. Yes.
Do you have information on how much the product is actually used?
How much?
It is used.
We use it on our medical school. We have all about 900 objects, 700 and something users. We also have our school uses Moodle as a learning management system. We also have Moodle, but I don't know how many resources are described in Moodle, because these two systems are connected. It's Melina Plus and it's Moodle. When a learning object is created on one system, it's available for searching to the other system too. I'm not sure about the Moodle. I think it's, I don't know, I'm not sure. But we have 900 learning objects right now in Melina Plus on medical school and about 700 plus users. We have information about repurposing, yes. We can see detailed statistics. But we don't have many information on how these specific objects are used. For example, as a developer, I would like to know if are usable for users that prepare assignments or presentations for their work, for the classes. We don't have right now this information. This is called education analytics. This is another field. We are making some tries to develop tools and technologies for gather such analytics, but right now the information we have is very limited.
Dimitris, we have to thank you here and to stop.
Thank you, and I'm sorry for the...
Thank you very much.
Thanks.